Welcome to the Purgatory Yacht Club, bitch. That can hear you.
And I can feel your negative energy from here.
Let's fuck it up.
Thunderation!
Get over here and suck me off already! Makes me that much stronger. Makes me work a little bit harder. Makes me that much wiser. Thanks for making me quieter. Maybe learn a little bit faster. Make my skin a little bit thicker. Makes me that You're like a master fader.
All right, I am not going to waste another second. Let us bring out this amazing panel of behind the strong female character. Let's welcome them warmly. It's Danny Kind, Tam Duarte, Rachel Ancherel, Savannah Baisley, and Bo Smith. Bring it on.
You're so funny. What is this? Are we playing a game? Oh. So excited. Whoever thought of this is
Welcome. And since everybody's slightly distracted, and the first item anyway was the items in front of you on the table, each one of them represent at least a part of your character. So why don't you go ahead and tell the audience what you have
in spiders! I disagree with this one, but whatever.
Say what?
Babies!
I'm sorry.
Spinning.
With the skull IV wed.
A megaphone.
And I'm sorry, Bo, I tried to get small comic books.
That tracks.
And I must have bad breath because there's a mint. Yeah.
No, it's a Ricola in case you have you're having trouble talking.
We all do.
The talking you're doing. Yeah.
It's because I've gotten COVID at all the cons. So if you're feeling scratchy, it's because of me. They're looking out for you.
So really, these are just if you feel like throwing them into the audience at any time you feel like doing.
Like now?
Skull!
Okay, you can do it now.
I'm gonna go.
Mine are a little sharp.
Savannah, yours is a little dangerous.
Oh my god, like I said, watch your eyeballs. Four.
And
school. There we go.
Yeah!
Did you get it?
So watch out. There's still some items
I'll
up on this table.
Out,
so look out for your eyes. Yes, Savannah's, yours is slightly hefty.
Mine are sharp.
Yeah.
Y'all want one? Over here.
There we go.
Okay, here we go.
Let me see how far I can get this one.
I'm lobbing a little lightly, and I'll do one more.
I did not lob lightly, I apologize.
We whipped.
And then
we
whipped them out later.
Lovingly whipped them.
Well, now I wish I brought more. I am sorry, Tam.
Like this?
Oh, yeah, they're whistles.
So, yeah, keep an eye out, especially the ones on that end of the table. There's more coming your way.
Yes.
So, I am sorry, Rachel, I'm going to pick on you. This is your first ERPCon.
Thank you. I think.
Is it your first convention overall, any kind of convention?
Ever.
Ever.
I've hidden. Virgin!
What? You're about halfway through. What do you think so far?
I love you, ERPers. Thank you. Thank you for being so welcoming, and it's so nice to see everyone again, too, and meet faces that I never got to meet, and see faces that I haven't seen in a while, so, and to meet everybody. I feel very honored to be here. So, what took me so long?
What took
I don't know.
think my mic. Oh no, I thought my no. I was going to ask what took you so long. Is my microphone working?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay.
I mean, aside from the fact that I feel like I'm dying of embarrassment right now. Oh my God, I am. But I don't know what took me so long. But I'm grateful to be here now.
So we are so happy to have you here now.
Thank you. You
played two pretty iconic characters on the show, so it's wonderful. It's wonderful to have you. Did anybody give you any advice before you came into like first con? Here's how to survive.
No, just have fun. I was like, oh, okay, that's specific. I love it. Thank you. But that's what I'm doing, and it's working out. So that was sage advice.
Sage advice. And then would you give, now that you've been here a couple days, you always have, you know, after tomorrow, you'll have one con under, and if somebody was going to their first con, would you give them any advice other than have fun?
Oh, come on. You took it. You took it. That's what I would have said. Have fun, and I guess be yourself. That's the only thing I that's all I got.
Oh my God. And for the rest of you, it's been a while since you, for some of you that have been to one of these cons and seen IRPers, what's it like being back amongst our family? Bo, we'll start with you down there.
Oh, well, it's great to be amongst all of the IRPers as always, but you know, I feel like we're kind of with each other all the time through social media. When you're looking at pictures of me walking the dog, what new pocket knife I bought that day. You know, it's rarely about work, but, before, Savannah, my name's Bo Smith. No one here has introduced us all this time.
Oh, really?
So, yes, it was nice to meet you and we get to do it. So, this works out good because I've admired your work from the rushes every day. So, you know, always get a kick out. And plus, I've got to be honest with you. Tim Rozon and I talk every day, and he gives me a running, all during the season, he gave me a running commentary, and it was all good.
Oh,
all
yay.
The time.
That's good.
So,
thank you so much.
The rest of you, it wasn't so good. I'm kidding about that. You know, Tim doesn't say anything bad. But what was the question again?
What's it like being amongst the IRPers again after time away?
Being the IRPers is great. I mean, that is 24/7 for me, and luckily enough, for the last 8 years, it's really come alive. They've made me appreciative of a fan base. And I don't even like to say fan base. They made me appreciative of a family that's not blood related to me, unless you're from West Virginia, or but just that has accepted an old turd like me, you know. And I really do appreciate that because I come from a different time age. You know, I'm dragging my knuckles. I rode a dinosaur to school. And you all are treating me like, you know, I'm an equal, and I appreciate that. And here I am on a panel with all these really smart, attractive women, and I am definitely the odd man out. So.
Well, as we'll discuss, all of them have, you know, brought to life various strong female characters, but you created Wynonna Earp, so you were sort of behind that very strong female character.
I was just going to say, it's so crazy that you write women the way that you do, because you're so demure and sweet, and yet you write these, like, fucking women, you know? That's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Although I've met your wife, and she's pretty fucking fantastic, so I can see why.
Yeah.
Thank you, Danny. I appreciate it. Was that demure enough? The weird thing about it is my whole career, I've been doing this for 38 years, almost 40 years, and my whole career was built on within comic books of writing two-fisted manly tales. And to be honest with you, one of the first to start writing stronger women. But forever, I was known as the Titan of testosterone within. I'm not kidding. Everything was a beer bottle in each hand and kicking somebody in the teeth. And then when Wynonna Earp started, I became the Emperor of Estrogen. So I want to thank all of you all that have helped raise that level for me, that I can become the sissy boy that I am today.
Yes.
I would argue that it makes you a hell of a lot more masculine to write these women than it does those testosterone.
Well, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Well, Danny's never seen me with my shirt off either, so.
Yet.
Yet. Yet.
There's still time.
Sorry, Jill. I hijacked.
You go. How about you, Savannah? I think this is your second ErbCon. Is that right?
Yeah, this is my second. I was at ACON before, so this is my first Herb Division one. And it's amazing. It's really fun. I really enjoy it. It's a very humbling experience in one of the best ways possible to have everybody, every time I have all these interactions, it's very, I never know what to say because I'm just everyone's so excited and I'm me? Me? And it's just really cool to know that everyone really appreciates the work and stuff, and it's really cool. Very flattering and humble, and just feel very blessed to get to experience it all. So thank you so much.
You already did me.
It's, oh, yeah. It's my turn.
I'm done. I'm finished.
I thought I was just...
Tamara's taking a fucking nap. With her eyes open. What's happening?
Whoa.
I'm on a panel.
No, I'm deep in thought. I'm totally thinking about this situation.
Totally. Yeah.
I'm so deep in thought.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I'm dying. No, it's been 2 years, I think, since my last con.
Really?
Yeah, I think so. Can anyone
verify
this information? Yeah.
Confirm or deny.
But it doesn't feel like it. It's you come and you see the same beautiful faces, and you get to have these. And it's interesting because I think we kind of communicate through social media, so you don't really miss a beat, but which is nice, and you get to catch up with a lot of friends, and that's what it feels like. It feels like you're catching up with friends, it's like you didn't miss a beat. You're just okay. We're back at it. So that's really cool. And there's just the sense of belonging, which is nice.
Yeah,
yeah, it's really cool. Yeah. And I wasn't sleeping with my fucking eyes open.
And I can catch some Z's on the panel.
I was deep in thought.
I love coming to these because I haven't experienced a con outside of this. My only, I've been to a bunch and they've only ever been Winona Earp. So you guys have set the bar so high. So if I, whatever else I ever get to experience outside of this is probably going to suck. But I don't feel any pressure. I feel like I can come, I can dress the way I feel like dressing, I can be myself. I don't feel like I have to put anything on for you guys ever. It's just a really nice, and I hope everybody else feels the same. I don't get the sense that anyone feels judged because of the way you guys show up, Mm. It's just a really nice, so thank you for making me feel that way. It's really nice. Very welcoming.
So each of you came to the show at a different time during the show. Rachel, you actually have been there since season one, before it was a thing, it even aired. Danny and Tam, you came in season two.
Season two, yeah.
As did you, Bo. You had a little appearance there in season two. And then Savannah, you came at season four, right? So you all came at different times. For Rachel, we haven't heard your origin story, how you got cast, how it was pitched to you, did you audition for Doc Holliday?
Who told you that? Stop.
Secrets. We all know the secrets. So how...
I auditioned for one other role. I don't want to say what role it...
I want to know.
You can go ahead. Go ahead.
Did you see the audition of the other role?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm just.
Go ahead. No, really, truly, you can mention.
No, because she's so badass in the role, and I can't I can't. It's Miss Kate Drummond's role. Who? God, she's Legato.
I can totally see you doing that.
Yeah. Not like Kate.
That's
no,
in
I
your
mean,
wheelhouse, though.
It's. Yeah. I mean.
That's cool.
It was a cool audition. I'm not gonna lie, but the blacksmith was. That was super special too, because some of you know this, because I, as you know, and I was saying that, like, when I was a kid, I worked at a living history museum. Like, I volunteered there, and I learned how to blacksmith. So I can actually operate a forge, and I can actually make a nail, and I can actually make chain link, and that's pretty much it. But still, I was super excited, because I was like, oh, my God, a blacksmith. And then when I got to set, and I was like, oh, I can do this. And they were like, don't touch it. And I was like... And they're like, safety. I was like, but I don't touch
Nobody
it.
Nobody trusts actors.
No!
No.
And with a hot poker, I mean, I think they were like, girl, you were, So that was...
poker wasn't actually hot, was it? I was like, really, was it? Did you burn somebody?
No, they wouldn't let me. I mean, not that I wanted to. But no, it was orange spray paint. But it was impressive, right?
It looked real,
and it was steaming, and it was super fun. And I'm so grateful to have played that role. It was Maddie was awesome.
And then when you got invited back, did you go like, nah?
Are you kidding me? I was like, yes, Maddie's coming back somehow. And they were like, no, it's Greta, her evil, vengeful, salty bitch twin. And I was like, okay, cool. So we'll see how this goes. And she was cute, I guess. But I missed Maddie. Really? Yes. Yeah, I really.
But
yeah.
It's Wynonna Earp. You never know, like, right? Know. All the characters.
Careful what you wish for, right? Is that the thing?
Okay, did you play the most... like different, like I feel like it was you because you just had every time I see you on a screen, I'm like, is that Danny? No, that's Danny. Is that Danny? That's Danny too. What the fuck? It was awesome.
It was awesome.
So what were the phone calls like when Emily was like, okay, and now do this and now do this?
Or she'd never give me a heads up unless I think she told me a couple times that I died. That she was just like, okay, so you die in this script, but like you don't die. You know, it was like, but like, honestly, to her credit, like, no other showrunner would do that. You would just get a script, and then you would have a fucking heart attack as an actor and be like, oh, they hate me, and you'd go down a wormhole. And Emily is so protective of her cast and so thoughtful in her work and has such high integrity as an artist that she reached out for those reasons but didn't tell me anything else and just, like, let me run.
And you never hesitated, like, when they're like, okay, you were going to be wearing this blue outfit with a whip.
Man, like, the fucking wardrobe, Jen, the wardrobe was so fire. Yeah, she is like, I don't know how she does what she does in Calgary, because it's not like they have a lot of stuff there. And she outsources and brings things in from other places and, like, has a team sewing shit and, like, just stuff she's imagined. Like, it is, no, I was like, anything you want me to do, Emily, anything you want me to wear, Jen, just put 17 layers of Spanx on me and call it a day. Like, I don't care, I'll just figure it out, whatever. No, there, I was game. Yeah.
Well, and it came across on screen.
Good.
Awesome.
Good, thanks.
And Bo, how did your cameo come about?
Oh, gosh. I think Emily was getting me back for every secret to the show that I was letting out on social media. Hilarious. Because she was constantly DMing me saying, Bo, we can't talk about that. But she kept saying, you know, even the first season, she goes, you know, next season we wanted to get you in for your Stan Lee cameo type thing. And I said, well, thank you for the comparison, but there is no comparison. But it was one of those things where, again, Emily got Wynonna Earp. She gets everything. She's got these eyes that can be in the right place at the right time all the time. And everyone was going, well, Bo, you can be, we'll have you at the banker, we'll dress you up, or we'll, you know, be a street merchant, maybe you'll be a street bum. I mean, you know, they had all kinds of things they were suggesting. And Emily finally just said, no, I want him to be Bo Smith. And so she dressed me as I've been dressing the same way since the 70s. Beth calls them my uniforms. You can look at pictures of the last 8 years of Wynonna Earp, and I've just got 10 of the same shirts that I bought and the same pants. And the ball cap to the whole thing, and she did that. And everybody, Tim was going, well, are you going to give Mr. Smith some lines? And she goes, no. She goes, for once, we're going to have him be quiet. So it was, and Ron was doing the directing that day. He goes, I want Doc to come in and you to go out after you've fondled this weird-looking doll in an antique store. And we were going in, and he goes, just kind of give each other, you know, a look of a, you know, like, I know you and that kind of thing. Well, Tim upped the game. When he came in, it was not only is he, you know, 2 inches taller than me, he wanted to give me that dick eye, you know, that, like that. So I had to give it back, and that was as much as my emoting I've ever done. And we did that, but I want to sidebar on that for just a second. Everybody on this panel, and plus I've told the others, my respect for actors went up that day, because to do that 17 seconds on screen, I was there from 8 till 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And as a kid, everybody thinks they want to be a TV star, a movie star. Even me, I'm going to be the next Robert Forster, you know, that who no one knows who it is, but that's the kind of weirdo I was. But I don't know how you all do the repetition, the constantly looking at whoever you're acting with and meaning what's in there and running over those lines. How many times have all of you all been stuck in not a lot of clothes out in the Calgary snow? There's just so many things. Yeah. And I knew right then I would drive myself nuts. So as a writer, I like being in control, because when you're, especially a comic book writer, you're the writer, director, cinematographer, costumer, casting director, you're everything. You have complete control. There's no budget. And my hat is off to whatever they pay you all is definitely not enough, and I really mean that. And if I had anything to do with the budget, you would have been paid the right amount.
They may all want, that, you know, right? Just put that in writing. And...
But that is, that 17 seconds gave me a whole huge respect, not only for television and film, but for the actors especially.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Bo.
I think someone should make a gif out of Bo Smith saying dick eye. I'm just going to say that.
Just a suggestion.
Yeah.
And so, Savannah, you came in the latest. How was, and Wynonna Earp was sort of a thing. When, did you know it was a thing? Like, there was a big fandom, saved the show from almost certain death for the third time.
Uh-huh.
Of that? Were you cognizant of any of that when you...
No, I wasn't. I wasn't aware at all. I had gotten the call that I had gotten the part, like, a week before I had to go out. So I was very much in a rush to try and, like, you know, figure out, at least, like, watch some of it and figure out the tone and everything like that. And then I kind of just started getting on to, like, learning my lines, because it was my, like I said, I've said this before, it was my first, like, guest role. So I was, like, really, really nervous. So I was like, I gotta make sure that, like, I'm good and they don't, like, think that, like, they made a mistake when I get there and they're like, why did we hire this girl? So I was, like, so... wanted to make sure that I had everything, like, as much as I could memorized. And then it wasn't until I was on set, we're, like, in the green room, like, on the chairs, and everyone kept saying something like, oh, yeah, the Earpers or this. And I was like, excuse me, what are their Earpers? And then they were like, oh, you don't know. And I was like, no. And so they were, you know, they were all telling me all about it. And then I went home and I, like, looked it up and I was like, oh, this is big. You guys have some really, like, cool fans, and I think it was a lot of the way hot, like, the YouTube and stuff. And I was like, oh, okay.
there's a little bit of way hot content out there.
Just a little bit. You know, just a little bit.
Sprinkled through the Wynonna Earp stuff.
Yes, a lot of Mel saying, like, boobs. So,
boobs. There's a lot of boobs.
Yeah.
That's also a running theme within the panel, definitely. Yeah. How was the character of Cleo sort of pitched to you? How did you understand it? How did you go play it? It turns out to be, in our minds, like, kind of an evil character. Is that how it was pitched to you, or was there some redeeming quality for Cleo?
Not a whole lot of redeeming quality. She was pitched as kind of, like, the bad. She was more so pitched as just, like, part of Mam's kind of, like, team. Ooh, sorry. That was a hard P. It was just kind of, like, pitched as one of Mam's, like, people. So I kind of got a little bit of a description of who she was. She was very... sassy. I don't think they use that word, but that's how I interpreted her. And so I wasn't exactly sure how everybody wanted me to play her. And so I just kind of, I think it was the horn was one of my first scenes.
You should throw one out now.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, the horn.
It's...
Who wants, okay. keep eyes up, everybody. I threw a lot this way, so I'm gonna throw one this way.
So much nicer.
Oh, nice. Why? My arm's not that long. Let's see if I can go a little bit further.
Oh!
Get my rugby arm back out. We got this one.
Throws the pitch.
There you go. We got one more this way. Yeah. Hey. Okay. I'm all out of porn.
All right. Oh, no, you have one right behind your placard there.
Just
if
kidding.
You want it. Yeah.
Okay. Do they actually work?
They're whistles. Yeah, they're whistles.
No way.
She wants one.
Oh, shit. I just landed right in someone's face. So sorry about that. So yeah, I just kind of got on the horn, and I just went for it. And then I looked over, and they were like, yeah, that's great. And I was like, all right, keep going. And so I just kind of like kept that energy, and it was, yeah. And then another time it was with Dom and Mel when I was in the police station.
Yep.
Yeah, everybody, and she was like, they were like, nice suit. And I was like, nice suit. Back. And then everyone was laughing, and I was like, okay, I think I got the vibe. I think I got it. So I just kind of kept that, like, very, like, energy going with her, and that's how she got her sass.
Nice, nice.
Yeah.
So... Bo, you obviously originated Wynonna Earp in the original comics, which I think were in 96,
yeah.
And then when the show started, some more female characters were introduced, a sister and a sheriff or a officer, and those started showing back up in your comics. How did you do, like, what did you take from the show to put in the comics for those characters, and what did you go, no, I'm going to take my comic females in a different direction?
Emily and I had a really good collaboration on, again, she can see stuff, and it was gifts for me because I did not create, you know, Waverly or Hot and the other characters, but it was like a gift for me because we could interchange between the comic books and the television series. She took Bobo Del Rey, Wynonna, Valdez, and put them on the television screen where I could use all of her characters in the comic books. And we always kept the universes separate. They were all the same character, but none of it was rehashed. Unfortunately, with the comic book, you know, we come out once a month. We could not do enough of those because I had plans for pretty much the whole cast in the comics. And we're still doing that, and that probably... as long as everything's going well, it will still happen. So everybody that's here will probably see themselves in my version in the comic book, so everyone be nice to me.
Yes!
But Emily and I had that, and it worked out really well because I never wanted, we didn't want to overlap and rehash anything with things. So it just turned out great. I mean, I've co-written with Melanie and Tim and Kat, and Dom in the comic books. Emily has always had an open door on that. It's just due to running the show and everything else. She's, you know, it's just so busy. That will happen at some point, and I will love that because that's we'll really be getting into the trenches. But I am big into collaboration, and that's always meant a lot to me. And Emily and I got to do that. She is the smarter little sister I never had. And my little sister was insulted by that, but she is. She just has a vision and for that kind of stuff. And it was great for me. I mean, I'm looking forward to putting some of the other characters in. So I was telling Rachel before we came out here that about the Valdez character, and if she would have been 6'5" and 200 pounds, she'd have been perfect for that. And in the comic book, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm expecting to see her grow between now and the next time I see her.
Apple boxes.
Yes.
A lot of them. I'm here for it.
That's right. And it was just, it's just for strong female characters. We've got every one of your all's characters that were played on the show. You know, I would see the rushes, but then I would see the show. Mercedes was, instantly I thought, I'm going to hate this character. Oh, man, she's mean. She's like every mean girl I ever knew. But my gosh, Emily and the writers managed to make her likable in ways and show things on heart that I didn't think was going to come. Every one of your all's characters did that. Mm-hmm. I thought, okay, she's going to be this evil henchman, blah, blah, blah. But still, your character had this sense of family within her own really dysfunctional family that I was thinking, well, don't kill her off. You know, I mean, that's the way I was lucky. I got to look at it as a creator of One on Earth, but at the same time, just as a viewer and a fan, and hoping that each one of you, I was pulling for you instead of Pam. I was pulling for you instead of Winona. I was thinking, maybe her and Tim can, you know. Let me finish.
I wasn't sure if it was Tim or Don, like which one you're pulling for. But now I know.
I was pulling for Tim because I thought Doc needed that. That was the perfect thing. And I was thinking, Melanie, you know, Winona, see, I get mixed up. Yeah. That was still mine, and I didn't want to see her going down the road yet. You know, I wanted to see her keep dating around. It was just that, that's the kind of fan slash weirdo that I was, you know, watching that stuff. So I had, you know.
Rosita has been left in a, you know, pretty good place. She's in a church with a bunch of gay nuns, I think.
Pretty sweet.
Yeah, it's a pretty good deal, I think.
Pretty good deal. Yeah. I'm down for it.
How was that coming back, that fight scene, filming that fight scene with
scene was great. Yeah. The fight scene was so great. Like even prepping for it, we had to come in the day before and kind of go through like what can and cannot be done, and even though I was pregnant, I was like, I can do that. And they're like, no, you can't. You can't.
Is it Steve doing the stunt?
Yeah. So it was great, like being able to, and it's like usually you get more time. Like a fight scene like that, you get 2 days minimum to prep for. And they're like, no, you got like 5 hours, so we gotta get on this. And we're like, okay, it just pressure makes diamonds. It just works. Yeah. It works.
Dropping bombs.
Dropping babies.
So I think everybody here knows, obviously, these actresses from their Winona Earp roles, but they have, all of them have appeared as strong female characters.
What are you pulling up on that computer over there?
So, here we go. I don't know.
Danny, so
I don't think you can see the screen, but. Maybe
are you going to show clips of shit?
No, I'm going to show photos of shit, though.
Thank God.
So this is just to introduce, you all probably know what you've appeared in, but just a couple of intros for other characters, like, maybe. So Savannah was obviously Cleo, but she's also appeared as a centuries-old vampire.
That's
a little vengeful, I think, the characters out to destroy, I think, a couple other vampires. And then also right now, sort of the snarky front office manager. That was you, Elephant, in some real estate. Rachel, we know Rachel as both Greta, Maddie and Greta Purley, obviously, but she's also been on Roogie Brew. Playing kind of a no-nonsense police officer, and also a Barzai.
Wow.
Security officer, thankfully not one in a typical red shirt that dies. Like
I wanted my red shirt back. They stole it from me, and they never gave it back to me. I think I'm the only red shirt in all of Star Trek history that was like, dude, where's my red shirt? And they were like, no, you're staying. I was like, I'm supposed to die. I don't understand, but cool.
If you don't know Star Trek lore, red shirts get killed off very quickly. They don't have any lines. They go down to the planet, and they get killed. That's security. And then, Tam, you are multiple advanced degree having biochemistry doing Rosita, but you've also been a medical student.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Danny.
Didn't we have dinner when you did. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Hey, do you remember that? In that little cute place?
Yes.
Oh, that was so sweet.
And also, maybe a slightly...
You're a baby! Look at you!
No, that wasn't that long ago. This is just stress from children. That was, like, really not that
slightly down on her luck, perhaps slightly coked out character.
Yeah,
on,
yeah. There's so a lot of addictions happening.
Addictions happening.
That's fun. Yes.
Oh, it was so fun. It was so fun. Actually, I have a story just really quickly about that.
Yeah, go for it, please.
So, I played an addict on a reservation, and I... they did this
crazy stuff to my face where they made it look really discolored and stuff. And then the DOP turns to the director and is
nobody,
like, hey,
what's a DOP?
Director of photography. So, like, they do all the lighting and stuff. And he's like, hey, like, I think we're going to have to light her a little differently because, like, it's, there's
oh,
a lot
they
of
thought
stuff.
Your skin was actually that.
Yeah, oh. And then they're like, actually, no, that's, like, that's cool. The way she, yeah, it was cool. And then that they, like, cool. Yellowed my teeth. It was really fucking cool. I loved it.
Yeah. And then, get my email reminders here.
That's nice that he was like, oh,
and then Danny, obviously.
I don't know what you're going to pull up.
The indomitable Mercedes Gardner. And then also.
So cold in that photo?
Oh, wait. He's a spider wife. Also, oh, that's also white on Earth. Oh.
And also.
She was also Porsche control on white on Earth.
Boots.
Oh, she was also a vampire. Also,
you're amazing. You're amazing.
Winona Earp.
This is great. Great.
But also, absolutely, as Anne Carlson. Working moms. I'm going to just unplug this now. That's all I have. So all of you have portrayed a lot of different kinds of characters throughout. What kind of character do you like to play best? Or is it just whatever they put in front of you? Like, what's your favorite kind of character to play?
Kind of like an evil character. I feel like I'm not, I also feel like more of a character actor than anything else, so I don't really feel like, I don't think I would ever get cast as like a love interest, or like, that's not my wheelhouse. I don't think that's what comes across. I'm not
Danny.
Warm and fuzzy. I think.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think evil. Like I like darker things. I like, I don't know. But also like what's the movie that I love so much? Cool, Danny. It's gone blank.
You. What is it about?
It's two people. Oh my God! Why is this happening? Natural Born Killers.
Yes.
Okay, like her in that role, nice. Juliette Lewis in that like dream role for me.
Oh, yeah.
Just fucking killing a bunch of people and going on a drug binge rampage. So fun. I think that would be so fun. Merry Christmas. Like, I don't know. But
no
Hallmark, don't you just want to, like, dive into some dark shit that you know, that you can't do in life and, like, live it out in a safe space? And I don't know. I think that's super fun and imaginative and makes me feel like a kid. That's all I got.
Yeah.
That's
really cool. And then also finding their, like, humanity, too. It's like the bad characters always
have
this, like, beautiful thing.
Sure.
No, why not?
No. But
no,
I think, and Bo spoke to that, too. Yeah. I think finding a little bit of heart in there is,
sure.
Is pretty, sure, heart, a nice thing. Heart. You know. But, I agree.
Yeah. I think I've steered away from, I'm like the opposite. Now
you
I'm like
nice things.
I want nice things.
Yeah, you're a nice person, that's why.
I used to be that way.
Yeah, you used to be a real bitch. And now you're like so fucking nice. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. She's a dear friend. I'm kidding.
No, I think like that's, I love that. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But I'm also like, maybe it's like being scared of it. Like, doing
but
it.
But you would get cast as a love interest. Like, you would be the babe that every guy falls in love with, and every woman falls in love with, and every dog falls in love with, and every fucking tree falls in love with.
Thanks.
Right?
Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that stuff affects me more now. Like, doing darker roles affects me more now than it did before. Before, I was like, fuck shit up. And now I'm like, in my hotel, I'm like, oh my God, how am I going to get rid of all of this energy and this? Because it does take a part.
It does.
It's very, and when you want to do it well, you want to dig to the depths of your soul and then die. So, like, I'm not.
It's
like,
hard to go
it's
home.
It's hard
and
to
be
go
a
home,
mom.
A mom after that. Yeah, it's definitely really hard. So, I'd rather be, like I've said before, like, do some, you know, Bluey. You know, like, or do, like, you know, be like a Brazilian cow on a fucking, you know, animated
show. Is this a spoiler
show.
Alert? Or are you
I don't know. Just
I can see you doing, singer. Like, Sandra Bullock's career, you know?
Yeah.
Like, doing, like, that kind of, like, comedy and that kind of, like, love stuff.
Yes, that's fun, too.
Love
that's
stuff.
Fun too. Yeah.
Yeah.
How about you, Rachel?
Oh, geez.
I love comedy. If I could make people laugh, that is my dream, but they never, ever want to see me cast in comedy. I'm always the villain, the ex-wife, the woman in the middle. I always get the bitch. But I think, you know what, it's... I exercise my demons this way, and then I can be fuzzy and happy in real life, but man, would I ever want to do comedy.
Write it. Mm-hmm. Write yourself a role, girl.
Mm-hmm. So, Danny, you writing something now?
I know.
What do you got going on there? You comedy girl. Come on.
I just think that this is really... We're not in Canada, but I think Canada is a really hard country because I don't know if culturally we understand our sense of comedy. And I just think it's very all over the place and not like... there's not a lot of risk taken in our comedy.
So yes. Can I just say something? There's in Working Moms, there was this role that I loved. This role.
Which one?
The scientist, the one with the Slurpee.
Teresa Pavlenek's role. Yeah, she got that. You wanted that.
I
was so fun.
Oh my God! Yeah. I want to send you my tape because I was sitting there. I put my glasses on. I had this straw. I was full on miming with this straw. I thought it was great. And they were like, it's too big. And I was like, I think I need to go work with Will Ferrell. Like, I think I need to go, you know, American comedy is so different than Canadian. Canadians very, keep it.
It's also being a female in comedy, though, is hard. Like, guys could get away with being big, but females cannot really get away with it as much, I think.
That's bullshit.
This is a whole other panel.
That's bullshit.
Thanks for the insight, though. Thank you. I actually, see, American, I actually got to, like, be ridiculous and have so much fun. And Jennifer Tilly was, like, super awesome. She encouraged it. And so did Dan. Like, they were like, yes. But I had to be a jerk and a villain and an asshole first. And then I was allowed to be charmed by Jennifer Tilly, which was great. So I did. I got to flex my muscles a little bit. So, yeah, it's good times. Thank you for pointing that out. Thank you.
Yes, I love playing villainous characters or morally ambiguous characters, I guess. You know, they don't always know that they're the bad guy and they're not trying to be the bad guy. They're just trying to live their truth, which just happens to not always be the best choices. But yeah, I really enjoy playing those. I'm a very, my favorite type of genres are usually... Sorry, there's a dog.
I know. I'm
sorry. No, it's okay. I was trying so hard not to look, and I was like, it's a good boy or girl. Yeah, you are.
It's a good boy.
Squirrel.
Yeah, literally. My favorite genres are usually, like, I'm usually watching something that's horror, thriller, psychological thriller, maybe a drama, and then I'll be like, fine, I'll watch a comedy, but, like, why are you trying to tell me to laugh? You know, like, don't tell me what to do. so usually I really enjoy those, but as everyone was saying, there is something cathartic about playing those types of characters, and I kind of like getting into the psychology of the characters and working my own stuff out through that, like, you know, what made you the way that you are, what trauma made you you know, defend yourself, or, you know, whatever, in this type of way, build these walls up. And I also find playing them is really fun. I find I don't always have to worry about if I said something too mean or if I was, I think Danny said this before, like if I was like pretty enough, like doing the take or things like that.
Did I purse my lips enough?
Yeah, did I purse my lips
or
enough?
Too much,
should I, you know, whatever it was. Like I remember one time I was filming something and I had my jaw trembling, and the director was like, can you try not to do that so much on the next take? It's distracting. And I was like, you mean you want me to look more, like, sexual or whatever? And, you know, while I'm crying, you want me to look prettier? Which, you know, sometimes during villainous stuff, you don't always have to worry about. And I just find it very freeing and fun. It can be fun to play those characters. And... yeah, I've just never really related to the ingenue type of thing. I just really enjoy getting to play villains. They're fun. They're very, very fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Wait.
I take back everything.
I
want to
know. Hold on.
Interject something. Not now. In Chucky, who played Chucky's voice?
Does anybody know this. It's
Brad Dourif.
Yeah.
All right. Longmire. Okay, you were in Longmire, right? Mm-hmm. And that was written by, you know, the based on the books by Craig Johnson, right? Mm-hmm. Craig Johnson went to my rival high school when I was going to mine. He's born and raised Huntington, West Virginia. Mm-hmm. Brad Dourif, born and raised Huntington, West Virginia. Winona Earp, born and raised Huntington, West Virginia. Mm-hmm. You can't tell me that stump jumpers can't write and do creative stuff. We may come from a small, but I was just noticing as we were going down through that, I said, I know all these people.
That's
from,
crazy.
You know,
that's crazy.
And we're a small, fairly small town.
Wow.
And Craig's mom didn't live all that far from me. You know, and he and I'd sit and talk. I gave him one of the first issues of Winona Earp when a kid goes, oh, I've seen the show. He goes, I really like that. And we were just sitting there. So West Virginia is an up and rising place, folks.
Up and rising.
That and Canada together
up and
will,
rising.
You know.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I just wanted to throw that in.
I thought you were
going to
say what your dream role would be.
Yeah. Oh.
What was your dream role? We're going to go
over
it.
It wouldn't be as an actor, but if I could, it'd be the same thing. And this is going to just fall right in. I think you're setting me up on this. I love Hallmark movies.
Of course.
Beth Latesk.
Of course.
I was more excited when Tim, Mel, and Kat were on. I said, you made it. You're on a Hallmark movie now.
Yay.
And they were like, Tim's going, don't say that out loud.
Yeah.
That's right, you know. But I was truly, Beth will tell you, if other people turn to drink, alcohol, this, I'm feeling bad. I turn to Hallmark movies. I know how they're going to end. I know at 20 till, that's when the confrontation comes at 5 till. They're going to finally have the kiss. It's going to be done.
Yeah.
Everything is clean and colorful. And, I mean, I've written comics for 40 years. I've done the darkest, nastiest stuff you can do. I've killed people without thinking about it. So I yearn for a Hallmark. I've got the spots, the socks, the blanket, the whole thing. I will never be the king of the titan of testosterone again.
No.
It's all taken away.
No.
Thank you, Danny. Thank you.
And thank you all. We are unfortunately out of time, but thank you so much again for coming. And let's give our panelists a
thank you, Jill.
A big
thank you, Jill. You did great.
Thank you.
Crushed it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, wait.